So friends, the last presentation for the day, it's Scilab Arduino. So friends, give a huge round of applause for them.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, Mansa, for making it so interesting. And I hope we would also be able to match up that level, though our presentation is quite simple. So our project topic was under Scilab Arduino Toolbox, which comes under FOSI group, of course. Now our mentors, Rajesh sir, Manas sir, and Samrut sir. Here's our team, Pavni Shukla, Sonal Singh, which is me, Sudhakar, Kiranmai. Tanmai had to leave early because of some other issues. She had a workshop to attend. So I'll give you an introduction, basic overview, which consists of the introduction about open source, Arduino, Scilab, Xcos, then the interfacing part of Scilab and Arduino, then the main toolbox, Scilab Arduino toolbox, which is used to link Scilab with Arduino, the hardware. Now, then Xcos blocks, then MPU 6050 block, which was created by Kiranmai and Abhilasha. So then in the end, we'll explain you with a demo and we'll implement the Modbus protocol, which is a standard industrially used serial communication protocol using Scilab Arduino Toolbox. It has not done before. So open source, as you all know, has been divided in two parts, open source software and open source hardware. Softwares are those parts whose source code is published and made available to the public. Same is with the hardware. The designs, basically, they are free to study, modify, and distribute to common people. Arduino is the standard open source hardware. And the board which we are using, it is Arduino 328, has 32 KB RAM. And you have different memory spaces. So you have different Arduino boards for that. The development environment, the Arduino hardware that needs to be programmed using a special software, that environment is Arduino IDE, Integrated Development Environment. So now Scilab, you all know it isn't, because the previous, all the demonstrations and all the presentations were upon Scilab. So it's a free and open source software for numerical computations. It has very powerful computing environment. It is almost compatible, almost comparable to MATLAB, though it is not exactly same as MATLAB. Still, it is developing and has excellent matrix manipulation capabilities and hundreds of inbuilt functions. Then these are the list of things that you can do with MATLAB. These one thing in each is a huge application and used widely in industries. So MATLAB, why there is a need to replace or have an alternative for MATLAB? Because it is really costly, first of all, and but really useful. It is used widely in the industries, but hardly people have a real, like, true original copy of MATLAB with them. So there was a huge need for Scilab introduction. So now in Scilab, we have the graphical editor that is called as Xcos. So this is basically for those who, there are some people who are not from the computation and computing background. They don't know coding. So for them, these blocks, individually, they represent the functions, or it is like Simulink in MATLAB. There you have different blocks for your entities like power or sources. So you just make circuit diagrams and then just execute it, and it will, and do the same similar hardware connections, and it will automatically run your code the same as it would write in a script of Scilab. So it can directly do it. It is used for designing hybrid models and huge circuitries. It is really good for those who can't code properly. So in our Scilab Arduino toolbox, we have included this part also. So Arduino being a hardware component and Scilab software. So one side we have open source software, which is Scilab. Now other side we have open source hardware, which is Arduino. So this combo is the best because you have open source and open source. So Arduino IDE, though you have Arduino IDE, you'll say, what is the need of Scilab? I can program an Arduino with an IDE. So Scilab, as I told earlier, for complex computations, it is the best. And Arduino IDE does not provide you with that much of wide range of applications. In Scilab, you can just drop plots, do huge amount of processing of data and all, which are never given in Arduino IDE. So how is this done? Scilab does not provide you with direct serial communication with the Arduino board. So what do you need to do is load a firmware in the Arduino board. Arduino board only understands the Arduino IDE commands. So it can only be programmed through Arduino IDE because it has been inbuilt in the bootloader when you're programming the microcontroller. There, we can use only this software to program it. So we are loading a firmware in Arduino board. So, and the user is having a Scilab interface. The bridge, which is the Arduino toolbox, which we have developed, the bridge is used to connect Scilab to Arduino board. So the commands which you were giving in Arduino IDE, those can be given through Scilab interface using the toolbox. Here the firmware maps the corresponding commands in Scilab interface, like open serial port or close serial port, to establish the serial communication between your computer and a hardware board. So that is done using Arduino toolbox. Now these are the basic macros, or you can say commands or functions, which are used in the Arduino, which are there in the Arduino Scilab Arduino toolbox. We have this open serial, close serial. These are used to the open serial command. It opens the serial port for communication. It takes some inputs as your Arduino number and port number and all, baud rate. So the rate at which you're transferring the data, open serial, close serial. And there is digital in digital. Same, all the things which are there in the Arduino IDE have been replaced here with these commands. And these had to be programmed and written. So next we have XCOS blocks. How those blocks, the graphic user interface, was made, that would be explained by Kiran Mai.
Hi everyone. Already Sonal has given a good description of the Scilab. So I'll be giving the description about XCOS blocks and how do we create the XCOS blocks in Scilab and Arduino toolbox. So first of all, when you open a XCOS, we actually have two windows in it. One is a palette browser and one more is a XCOS editor window. The palette browser is a window where actually we select the blocks and drag and put it into the XCOS editor. And XCOS editor is where we actually have the simulation will be done in that window. So coming to the creation of the blocks, for creating blocks, we actually need two functions. One is an interfacing function and one more is a computational function. Interfacing function is where the parameters, the size and size of the block are defined. It is actually defined in the format of SCI file, where the SCI file is a format of doing the scripts in Scilab. And computational function is actually defines the behavior of the block. It can be defined, meaning those functions are defined in either C or SCI file. So these are the two windows. One is a palette browser and XCOS, and we can drag the block and put it over the XCOS editing window, and we can simulate the model. As our project is about the Scilab Arduino toolbox, this is the Arduino toolbox, which consists of configuration, digital, analog, and motors. Configuration actually consists of Arduino setup, where we actually have to give the card number. Card number is like how many Arduino boards we are using, and we have to give the COM port number, which is given by the shown on the PC. And time sample is for the sampling period, An Arduino scope is to view the plots. And similarly, we have digital, analog, and motors with different blocks. And I've created a block for MPU6050. Actually, MPU6050 is a world's first six-axis motion tracking device where we have accelerometer and gyro sensor with digital motion processing. It actually tracks the motion of a device. So actually, the accelerometer and the gyroscopes or gyroscope is both the sensors are directly embedded onto the MPU6050, and that is how it's really featured very high. So this is the MPU6050 block. This actually reads the value, reads the coordinates of the device. Like accelerometer will give us values, three values, either x in the x, y, z direction, that is given by the accelerometer. Then the gyroscope will give the angular velocity of the device. This is a simple basic application where we get the values from the MPU read using the MPU6050. So this is the X-COS block. And these are the plots which I have got along YPR direction, where YPR is nothing but YAV, pitch and roll, which gives values along side-by-side rotation and front-to-front rotation and front-to-back rotation. And these are the values. And as it is created on X-COS, I have created the same macro functions on Scilab also, which are three functions. One is launch, read, and stop, where launch will initialize the MPU6050 and read will read the values, whatever is read by Arduino from MPU6050, and MPU6050 stop, it will actually stop the acquisition of the MPU6050. It actually stops the values. So this is a code which has three functions, and this is the values which I have got, AX, AY, AZ. And one more application is like I can control the DC motor by using MPU6050. This is the X-COS block where the motor runs from the speed of 255 to -255, and it actually selects based on the input of, meaning the changing of movement of MPU6050 as it controls. So these are the plots which I have got, and the next application will be done.
Good evening, everyone. I know some of you might have got saturated, but now this is something really interesting. So now what we did till now was that we told you about Scilab. We told you about X-COS. We even created a Scilab Arduino toolbox in order to connect Scilab with Arduino. And we built a block and then demonstrated an application using it. But the question which comes now is that, can this be used in industries where large amount of equipments are required? Can it be used? So for demonstrating that, we have implemented the Modbus protocol. So what we are doing here is that we are dealing with the Modbus protocol, and we are using a master and a slave. The master in our case is the Arduino, and the slave is the energy meter. So you might be wondering, what is Modbus? So Modbus is an industrial serial communication protocol. It is used to connect supervisory computer with RTU, that is the remote terminal unit. Now take an example of a cement industry, where there is limestone in one place, then it gets pulverized in another place. So different raw materials are present in different small places, but there's a control unit where everything is getting monitored. So how will we know what is happening at each place? So SCADA, or supervisory control and data acquisition, is done where there are many remote terminal units. So for communicating, with that, we use the Modbus protocol. So using Modbus protocol has many advantages. For example, we can monitor many remote terminal units and not just one. Here, as it is written, we can monitor up to 247 slaves if we use the RS-485 serial standard. So here comes the question, what is RS-485 serial standard? RS-485 standard is a recommended standard which is used in mostly in case of Modbus protocol. Now if we I know many of us know about RS-232. So the maximum range we can use RS-232 is just 50 feet. Now if we have in industries, if we have long distance communication, then it is not possible to use RS-232. Another reason we don't want RS-232 is that it's not differential signal and hence there's a chance of the noise getting added there. And the data transfer rate is also just 20 kb per second. But if we use the RS-485 serial standard, as you can see here, this is the RS-485 module. The data transfer rate is 100 kilobytes per second. And it can transfer up to 1200 meters. Using RS-232, we were getting just 50 feet. And this is differential pairs of signals. As you can see, that is A and that is B, which is just D plus and D minus. So the noise gets cancelled. And multiple slaves can be used. Using RS-232 standard, which we normally do, we can communicate just through one unit and not through many units at a time. But using this, we can communicate with multiple slaves. So this is the RS-485 module, which we have used here. It contains A and B for differential signals, and then VCC and ground. This is the main chip, MAX-485. This is a received output pin and data input pin, which is just RX and TX, and receive enable and data enable. Now, how does Modbus protocol work? We'll just take an example of a simple master and slave system. So there is a master. It would initiate a request. For example, I want the value of voltage at one plant in some particular meter. So I will initiate the request. I would send it to a slave. And then the slave will perform the action. And then it would send another response. And this response I will decode. The master would get that response. And then I'll tell what the value exactly is. So I guess you might be knowing that we can't send the request directly. It has to be in some encrypted form or in the form of packets. So let us see just a brief intro to how the packet exactly looks like. So for example, a packet we send is always of 8 bytes, but the data we receive can be of variable bytes. So if you see that is in hex. So the first two digits correspond to 1 byte. The first thing is that since there can be multiple slaves, we don't know which slave we are communicating to. So first is the slave ID. In our case, it is 11. Then the second is the function code. Using Modbus protocol, we can do many functionalities. For example, we can read the analog value. We can read the digital value. We can write in some digital coil or analog coil. So function code is 03, which means we want to read the analog value of some register. And then 006B is the address, which tells the memory register which we want to access. And then after that, the number of registers which we want to access is 0003. Now we have to note that each register is of 2 bytes here. And then 7687 is the CRC or the cyclic redundancy check. This tells if the data we have sent is valid or not. More will be told to you by Sudhakar shortly. So the packet we have received in this case is 11, which is the slave ID. Now since if there are multiple slaves, so firstly the slave would check if the slave ID is matching or not. If it's not matching, then it would reject the packet. So this is the slave ID. Then 03 is the function code. Then next to it is the number of bytes. Since I told you that there are only 3 registers, and each register consists of 2 bytes each, the number of bytes the data would consist of would be 6 bytes. And then there comes the byte received. So you can see the 6 bytes of data. And then there's the CRC or the cyclic redundancy check. So what we did was that we used an Arduino and we implemented Modbus protocol. So here you can see the Arduino, and which we have treated as a master in our case. And there's the energy meter, which is the slave. Now, obviously, we'll connect it through MAX-485. You can see the Arduino is interfaced in our computer using Scilab, and the hardware serial. For example, if you can see, most of you might have seen an Arduino Uno board. So 0 and 1 pins correspond to the hardware serial of Arduino board. So that we have connected, that is automatically connected to the CPU. But if we have to transfer data to a slave, we can't use those two pins since they are already reserved for serial communication with CPU. So we have, what we do here is that we'll declare software serial pins. So pin number 10 and 11, we declared them as software serial using a library and then we use them. And MAX 485 is the chip we have used. The RX is connected to the TX of MAX 485 and the TX to RX of MAX 485. And then since we are operating it in half duplex mode, so RE and DE, both the enables are shorted and connected to a control pin. And this is then connected to the energy meter. The energy meter is then connected to the load, anything, bulb, fridge, anything. This is just the flowchart of what I explained till now. So we start with the serial communication with Arduino. What we'll do is that using Scilab, we'll send a packet to the Arduino. Now that packet is received by the Arduino or the master. That Arduino would send the packet to energy meter. The energy meter would see the packet and would send the value of the required registers back. And then it would be sent to the Arduino, and from the Arduino, we'll read it using Scilab. So we have used software serial and hardware serial, so there had to be data transfer from hardware serial to software serial, so that we have illustrated there. Now after, as you saw there, the packet here was in hex format, but the values of analog pins would be in floating numbers, for example, 237.5 or something like that. So how is it decoded? So the value is 32-bit hex, and it is converted to floating point using IEEE 745 hex to floating point conversion. Okay. So now, what exactly is energy meter, the CRC checking, and this conversion would be explained to you by Sudhakar.
Thank you. Good evening to one and all. So everything is explained by our teammates till now. So as Pavni has already explained that we are treating our Arduino as a master and energy meter as a slave. So here the energy meter which we have used is brought to by Schneider Electric India. It is basically a three-phase electrical instrumentation. And this is the picture of that particular energy meter. And there are various functionalities in that particular energy meter. It measures the amount of electricity, no doubt. And apart from that, it measures the various parameters, like wedge voltage, voltage from phase to neutral, line 1 to 2, 2 to 3, several factors, and active power, reactive power, everything it measures. And apart from that, there are some interesting functions like energy integrated function, run dotage. For example, run dotage just describes that from how much time the load is running. And also the on dotage, which describes that from how much time the energy meter was on. And in order to read the various parameters like voltage, current, power, we have to mention the different addresses. So for example, voltage, we have the address 3927. And in the same way, for current, there is a different address. For power, there is a different address. So here, I would like to just take the packet which we use for reading the voltage on our energy meter. So here, we have used the slave address 1 because there is only one slave here. 03 is the function code for read holding registers. It is already specified by Modbus protocol. And here we have mentioned the address 3927, which is converted into hex first and then ASCII coded. And it is the 0F56. And after this, the number of registers to be read. And then for error checking and all those things, CRC, cyclic redundancy check. And here the LSB is taken first. And in response to that particular request, the Modbus sends something like this. Here, again, the 01 is the slave address, 03 is the function code, 4 the total number of bytes read. Till now, we received all these things after a lot of trouble, but in spite of being here, we had to face the problem because we are unable to decode this particular value. For example, in this case, our value is 2921 and 4373. So it was difficult that how to read this value in the user readable format. So we had to make the corrections IEEE 754 norms, and not only that particular, we had to read the value in Little Indian format. So we just, in Little Indian format, we mention the LSB byte first and then higher byte. It means that the LSB will be stored in the lower address and the MSB will be stored in the higher address. So our value was this much, and after IEEE 754 norms and Little Indian format, we get the value of 243.16 volt, which we will be demonstrating it very soon.
Why don't you just go to the demo?
Sure, sir.
That's what people are interested in. They want to see lights flashing.
So, sir,
all of us write soft things. We don't see anything.
Yes, sir.
You are the people who show something to us. Moving.
Okay,
part.
Sir. We would like.
I
to
don't think you have any moving part.
Yes, sir. Sir, the just a minute. We would like to show you the experimental setup. Correct. Here, this is the load and the Arduino Uno board along with the MAX485 energy meter along with the this load here. All the connections are in parallel. So we'll be getting all the voltages, whether one load is on or the two load is on. But in case of current and power, the voltage will vary according to the loads, number of loads. We will be showing it. So we would like to show it through the XCOS blocks, which we have prepared.
Basically, you will be reading the value that is being shown on that Snedden meter on your PC, right?
Yes, sir.
Without having to go there and call it out.
Yes, sir. So there is no load on and the value of current is zero. Now one load is being on and the value of the current will be shown on the Scilab console.
Depending on the value you received in Scilab, you will take some decision.
Yes, sir.
And then you will turn some slave on and off. Correct?
Yes, sir. We can use this as a SCADA system and we can use some control loops as well.
Correct. Because you got 247 slaves.
Yes, sir. We can connect.
You are only using one slave so far.
Yes, sir. Right now we are using only one slave.
So all those three bulbs were slaves, if the energy was
no,
more,
sir,
you would
those
have
three bulbs are serving as a load for the slave.
I know.
Yes, sir.
But if they were also slaves,
yes, sir.
Okay, you could have turned them off.
Yes, sir. Of course, we can take action based on the values.
Correct.
Yes.
To reduce the temperature, like shown by the other program.
Sir. We are having the value of current 0.27 ampere. So, as soon as we turn the second load on, so the current will be doubled. So the current is just doubled, and in the similar way we can show for the third load as well, and likewise we can show the voltage and the power which is being consumed by the load.
Okay. If we hand it to them, like I told somebody, the missile will go in a different place. A floating point error. No, it's okay. Go ahead. Don't worry.
He's giving a glaring look. Oh my God.
Okay, so now we can show the power as well. Yes, so for two loads it is, and similarly it can be displayed for the three loads as well. And in case of voltage, there will be no change because all the connections are made in parallel.
That meter should show the power, no?
Yes, sir. We have to change the buttons for the setting. So it is 133.8 approx, and
okay.
Yes, sir. And in the similar way, we can show the voltage as well.
Basically, you measured the second reading, that is power, by
yes.
changing something.
Yes, sir. We are sending the packets from Scilab. The packets.
But you change the thing to in Scilab here.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
And that send the that
send the particular
that send the signal to your Arduino.
Yes, sir.
Which said now I want the power.
Yes, sir. Here Arduino will be a master, and it will be transferring the packet to the slave, and slave in turn will respond. So this system can be basically. So this system can be designed for developing SCADA like systems and for control systems as well, and
let us break.
Yes sir, it's almost over, sir. No, just no, one or two minutes.
Be completely over, not almost. Again she's okay. Let me tell you something. These four guys, okay, who are not even engineers, have gone and conducted a workshop. Those batches they see are not. I don't have a batch. You don't have a batch. Okay. Some of them are organizers, and some of them have already. I think I saw a speaker batch somewhere. Okay. So she already, before boring us, she has bored somebody else. Okay.
And all the experiments which we had conducted during these days,
show
this has been already compiled in a book with the help of the condenser, and this is really, yeah. really a privilege for all of us. We all got a chance to become authors in this age.
Your name is there, no?
Yes, sir. All.
It is actually condenser's book, and we have just co-authored it. We have just helped him. It was actually his idea to conduct the workshop. Those are actually his experiments. He has designed them. We have just helped him with those. We have just co-authored the book. Yeah. Which we were all busy since morning over there, and we have worked really. It's like this and that workshop, they have gone parallelly. They were together. So these are the like few hours before, 1 hour before these pictures. Condenser is taking the workshop. Yeah, he's having this talk. So. In lecture hall 102. So we were all busy over there, and then we managed to come here. So. And a big thank you to Kannan Madgalya sir, then Professor Fatak sir, and N.K. Khosla sir. The Modbus idea was his, and Rajesh Koshalkar sir. Without him, it would not have been possible. Samrud sir and Manas sir. Without your help, we used to stay in lab. Like overnight, because the Modbus part was not working, we didn't know how to crack that thing, the slave ID and everything. We didn't know. No one had studied it. No one had studied it from like this basic as we did, because there was no documentation on it. And even the XCOS block part which she did, we found only one paper on it, how to make it. So we started everything from the very beginning, and that's why the slides are so many, because we were told to document it. So. Sorry to bore you with that, but then those parts were necessary so that the people who come after us, they get the things ready.
Yeah, thank you very much. Give a huge round of applause for them. So finally, it was a great day with all such great projects. I request everyone to give a round of applause for yourself for such a good presentation. We all have to gather again at 8:15. I suppose it's already 8:15. To Gulmohar, third floor, for the certificate distribution by Professor D.B. Patak sir, followed by our dinner. Lastly, I would like to thank all our dignitaries, mentors, and all the summer interns. Thank you, everyone. And surely I'm gonna miss you all. Thank you.